Hi, I'm Nancy Wilson, and you're watching Lifeminute TV.
You hear one of her heart licks and you can't miss it. She's one of the greatest female rock guitarists of our time. Four-time Grammy nominee and one of this year's Grammy Lifetime Achievement Award winners, singer-songwriter Nancy Wilson has led a storied career. She's recorded 16 albums, sold more than 35 million of them worldwide with her band Heart, and she's recently released her very first solo album called You and Me. We were fortunate to have her stop by the Life Minute Studios and get to celebrate her 69th birthday a few weeks back. She told us all about what she's been up to, even played us an acoustic set.
Dog and butterfly.
This is a Life Minute with the one and only Nancy Wilson.
Nancy Wilson is epic. Welcome to Life Minute. And on her birthday, no less.
It is my birthday. Yeah.
Absolutely amazing having you here. Thank you so
Thank
much
you
for coming.
Having me.
So
I
tell
was
us
in New York.
Yeah. Tell us about last night, Paul McCartney tribute.
Yeah, we did two shows. We did one at the City Winery with an audience, you know, for benefits, a bunch of children's causes for Paul McCartney, the songs, the music of Paul McCartney. And then last night was Carnegie Hall, which is such a stunning room to play in. I did the Paul Simon benefit here years ago with my sister. And it's a room built for sound before microphones were invented. So it has all of this beautiful reflectiveness in the room. The stage itself has a bass trap that was built out of the stone that they made the building out of. And they tried to redo that recently, but they had to go back to the original design. And anyway, they rebuilt it as per original specs that they made it. So the room itself is just an instrument on its own. And to hear people like Christopher Cross and, you know, Lyle Lovett just singing in this room, and it was fun to sing in that room. So we did Band on the Run, and I got to sing Mull of Kintyre with Denny Lane, who was in Wings band with Paul, and wrote that with Paul, as well as Christopher Cross and those guys. So it was just a big, you know, muso fest.
Yeah.
And really fun and good causes.
Very cool.
Were
awesome.
Served, yeah.
Awesome. Was Paul one of your inspirations when you're the Beatles?
Yes. Well, yes. Being a kid, when we saw them on Ed Sullivan, being a little kid, it was like the lunar landing, you know, it's like a cultural flash mob that changed the entire world. So we had to have guitars, we had to make a band, we had to learn how to write songs and sing and play and perform because of the Beatles, mainly. And it started a whole cultural trajectory that was, you know, still is unforgettable and is still imprinted in the culture forever. So growing up at that particular time with that music of the Beatles and the amazing stuff we were lucky enough to grow up with,
Who were some of your other influences?
Oh, well, you know, of course, the Stones and Led Zeppelin and Simon and Garfunkel and Joni Mitchell and Elton John and, you know, so many amazing things on the radio all the time. Back in the old terrestrial radio days where we, you know, I still listen to radio in the car, but now it's satellite.
Yeah. I know, I'm still not used to that, the satellite, and how you can stop it and rewind, and it's still bizarre to me.
Yeah. Well, it's convenient.
It is.
Yeah.
I still like my vinyl. I just recently
whipped
out another new vinyl, and rocking that again, so it's been
good. I love spinning vinyl at home with really good speakers. Yeah.
There's nothing quite like that.
Nothing sounds that good.
You're revered by so many as one of the greatest guitarists of all time, certainly female guitarists of all time, too. How does that resonate with you?
I love that. I mean, I started when I was a kid, about eight or nine, and I played the ukulele before that, and a little bit of piano along the way, but and mandolin. But it's my main man, the guitar, you know. It's my best friend. You can have a conversation with a guitar, and it'll sort of tell you what you want to hear, you know, like even just musically, you know. But yeah, it's an emotional connection that's really magical.
How did you know, when did you know you wanted to be a musician?
Oh, well, I was born a music person. Like, our family all sort of sang in choirs and played ukuleles, and aunts and uncles and grandparents. We learned a bunch of kind of off-color English pub songs as kids from them. And the previous generation, they had like funny stuff, and they had, you know, Spike Jones, and they had comedy songs. And so, and my mom played really good piano, and she taught us how to play, and we all harmonized. You know, we'd sit around and sing, you know, The Great Titanic, you know, and stuff like that. And so I really was lucky to be born into such a musical, a real musical, like the Von Trapps or something almost, because we all would go on a road trip and we'd sing in the car, you know, and the dog would howl, you know.
What gravitated you to that guitar? Like, how did you know it was that instrument?
Well, the guitar was a must-have guitar, you know, because I saw the Beatles playing guitars. It's like, I got to play the guitar. And Anne was funny because she got the first guitar in the family, and I was like, okay, she's walked out of the room, grabbed it, you know, and start tinkering. And then she'd come back in the room and go, hey! You know, she'd get mad at me for taking her guitar away. So I begged my folks to get me a guitar, and because I couldn't stop myself. And they got me a guitar, but it was impossible to play. You know, it was like a dowel pipe for a neck, you know, and it, the action was like so high off of the neck. You could never bar a chord to save your life on a guitar like that. But I got really strong trying. So now, you know, they call me Hands of Granite, you know, because I learned on a really difficult guitar.
So cool. And were you self-taught?
Yeah.
Completely?
Well, everybody gets the Mel Bay chord book at the music store. And it shows you like the C and the G and the E and the A and the D. But if you have an ear, you just learn. I mean, I learned to play, to read music for a while with piano and piano lessons and music theory later in university. But I never really needed to use it. I never had to write it down or read it. It's just all here. It's in my noodle.
So take us through the journey. I guess your parents were okay that you guys were both musicians. Anne was first, right?
Yeah.
You followed.
Well, Anne is 4 years my senior, and Lynn are 4 years again her senior. The three sisters of us always sang, of course, and, you know, on camping trips we'd go and sing, you know, Kathy's Clown to, like, random people in tents. So we had the performance bug, and Lynn got hooked up and married and got pregnant pretty early on. So then it was down to the two of us. And Anne started to sing with guys that had gear. Like, we played a lot of stuff just acoustically with various little groups of friends. And then she kind of split off and went with some guys that had a real drum kit, amplifiers, and a van, you know, so that she could go and do play places where she was old enough to play. If you were over 18, you could wait in the back. You couldn't be at the bar, you know. So I played a lot of places before I was old enough to drink. But of course, that didn't stop any of us at the time. Anyway, but we knew we were always destined to make a band together because we had the same idea. And it was to be as much like the Beatles, you know, not be their girlfriends, but be them, be the Beatles, you know. And we sort of got into the game early enough to not have any sort of sexual identity in the way. We were just kids that just were doing it. And so we didn't figure it was, we're not supposed to do it. Our parents encouraged us to do it. And they said, follow your bliss, was a saying at the time. Mm-hmm. So we did, we followed our bliss. And just really like confident that we were gonna make it. Like just confident that we had it in us, we were talented, capable, and we got better and we just did the homework and we learned our craft and pounded and drilled and got it right. And so it worked.
Yeah, sure did. Did your parents see you become famous?
Yeah, they got to be around when the first album got big. And my grandma was still around, one of them at the time. And she was like, oh, it's just so fun that it's going so well for you and your little orchestra. And we're like, yeah, okay, you know, I guess you could call us a little orchestra. But that was her generation, you know, because they went to theaters and they saw musical shows, you know. And so we've been really lucky. We've had our roller coaster, you know, along the way, of course. It was successful and then it was not successful and then it was successful again, you know, never stopped us from continuing to just keep after it.
Yeah. And I think that resurgence is going to happen. Yeah, the 80s are back. That second revival is going to happen again, I think. You know that?
Oh, not the 80s again, please.
Yeah, in a big way.
Help us all. God help us.
What inspires you creatively?
It's interesting how the muse kind of hangs around sometimes. And you're like, I want to write something like, I want to write a song called Weatherman, which I'm working on right now, because my husband Jeff he really likes the weather. He likes to report on weather, like, okay, there's another, you know, atmospheric river coming in, you know. But it's also an analogy for an emotional journey that you take with weather that you experience in your life. And so so I get inspired by emotional you know, painful things and loss and anger. So it's really a lot generated by emotional stuff. Mm-hmm. And then sometimes you just kind of go without any inspiration for a while. It's sort of like you have to wait a while, it builds up for a while, and then suddenly it kind of, the gates open again and you're, okay, I better write this album quick, you know. It's interesting how that, it comes and goes.
And you recently came out with your very first solo album. Tell us all about that.
Yeah. I started during the shutdown. You know, I was like, you know what? I'm sitting here trying to do this jigsaw puzzle, and I just don't feel like I'm getting anywhere. I mean, some people just love jigsaw puzzles, but I guess I'm not one of them. So I tried.
So you were really doing a puzzle.
I was trying my hardest.
Or a metaphor. Yeah. You were actually doing a puzzle.
Okay. Yeah, I was doing the actual 1,000-piece puzzle on the dining room table. And I went, you know, I should be doing something else with my time. Hmm. So I've got a new studio in this new house in Northern California where I can close off and make as much noise as I want. So people said, when are you going to do a solo album? It's like, yes, I want to do a solo album. I said that forever, and then it was never enough time to do it. But being shut in and at home, unable to tour, you know, it's like, now's the time. So I really was happy with it and proud of how it turned out.
So good. Yeah. And you invited some of your famous friends along.
Yeah.
About that.
Yeah, I sent some of the files to Sammy Hagar, the boxer, Paul Simon song, the boxer, and technically Simon and Garfunkel in that time, but he did some like cool rock voice stuff on there. And previous to the shutdown, I had worked with Taylor Hawkins on his solo album, great album called Get the Money. And I sang a song for him. And I said, do you have anything laying around that you, a jam or something, you know? I said, yeah, me and Duff McKagan. And they had a jam that they sent me, and so I was like, okay, I'll fix it up and I'll write a song to it. And so I did that on the album too. And it was just a really great project. It was really a survival technique to be writing music during the shutdown. Yeah.
And you created a song for Taylor as well, right?
Then the night I heard that he had, you know, gone off, that we heard that, it was really devastating because he was such a good friend. And just a beautiful spirit. His spirit was so light and funny. And he was kind of on the spectrum, this guy. He would even admit it. I was working in his studio. He'd like, okay, now if you want to sing it like this, more, a little more of this kind of syncopated part, like da 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 da, and then you could do it, and then this one melody and this other part there, and he's like, or I could just shut up right now and let you just try it again. Excuse me, I'm on the spectrum. And I was like, that's fine. I love it. You know, it's fine. No need to apologize for yourself. But then I wrote a song, you know, called Amigo Amiga.
Amiga, Amiga.
Because he always called me Amiga, and I always called him Amigo. So it was a, you know, sort of a call and response to him over in the other world kind of thing. Just, you know, where'd you go, man?
And you did a couple other beautiful tributes as well. One, Lane Staley, who's one of my favorites. I have a very short list of favorite musicians. Yeah, he was one of them.
Are they all from Seattle?
Probably.
Yeah. Me too.
I think that's neat.
It's the Seattle crew, right? Yeah. It's my buddies and brothers from there. I mean, the Northwest, you know. But the one I'd written for Lane Staley was actually in the early 90s when I started that song, and called The Dragon.
Where the dragon wanes.
You could see it coming that he was not going to win his battle with addiction, and heroin in particular. And it was a sad thing to see coming because everybody loved him. He was a sweet as they come person, but he just didn't have the ability to survive that. So, and it took a long time. And so that was even sadder, how long it took for him to disappear. But I started writing it then, and I finally finished it later because it just didn't fit in the heart category. It wasn't the best heart song. It was more of a Seattle song.
It sounded like
it had a Seattle thing of tuning and everything. So later I put it on the solo album. I recorded it a couple of times, but yeah, that was the main version.
What do you think, tell us what are the big differences playing with heart, playing, you know, your solo music?
Well, it's a really big difference. I mean, heart's a very, heart's a big iron horse. It's a big machine, you know. So we usually play really bigger places. And when I go out with my Nancy Wilson's Heart band more recently, we play in like outdoor sheds and theaters and big clubs and stuff like that. So it's much more of personal, you know. We're not a club band per se, but we play at performance centers, you know, places that are kind of built for sound. We played a show with the Seattle Symphony at the Ben Arroyo Hall, which was really fun. And it was the first show I'd had played in a couple of years since the shutdown. And because we'd all made the album remotely, you know, and then we took it, we all wore our masks and took them off to sing. But it was really, it's really fun to have a big, you know, kick-ass rock band, and then it's really fun to have a medium-sized kick-ass rock band, too.
Yeah, I like
being
intimate.
In at least one band, so. Last night, they were like, hey, Denny Lane, you know, now that we sang and played together, what are we going to call our band? You know, it's like, you can't have too many good bands. There's so many players that I've run into.
Yeah, who are some players, do you think, or like great guitarists, do you think, of today?
Well, I mean, if Eddie were still around, that would be so great. But his son, Wolfie, is amazing, too. And I would love to play with him. I'd love to play, I might just do a thing that they're putting together called about guitar riffs with my guitar player, Ryan Waters, who was in Heart as well. And the guy from the band called War on Drugs.
Yeah, Adam Grandisiel.
I love his playing. And there's just so many great guitar players. Mike McCready from Pearl Jam, and just a lot of great players. Jerry Cantrell.
I just saw him the other night in Jersey.
Oh, you did?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. He's out with his Brighton tour.
Yes.
Yes. Yeah. He's a brother to me, like all those guys are. But like we sat around in the 90s when we first met. He was like, okay, how do you play the beginning of Mistral Wind? You know, and I'm like, oh, cool. You know, you want to know about that, you know, because it's one of those real dissonant things like he does so well. That's his specialty, crazy dissonant rock guitar playing, riffing. And we've done stuff together. And Sammy Hagar, I do a benefit with him every year for this children's cancer hospital thing, acoustic for a cure. So I got to play with him and the guy, Metallica, and a bunch of guys like that. Bob Weir, really a great guitar player too, Bob Weir from The Dead. And there's a lot of great talent, you know. If you walk out your front door, you'll find it.
Mistral Wind came out in 1978. You created grunge. I think it's neat these rock guys look up to you.
It's funny. I like that because you're a woman. There aren't that many, you know, women.
There's starting to be like Boy Genius, and you know, Phoebe Bridgers and those guys, and because they're really competent, talented girls that are up and comers now, and Angel Olsen, and I'm starting a record. I mean,
yes,
not a record company, but
a management company.
A management company.
Tell us about that.
And we've signed this beautiful, talented young female artist who writes and sings. She's a singer-songwriter, basically, plays everything, produces her own stuff with her producer guy, and Madison XOXO. She's our first signing to the Roadcase management company. And, you know, we're just getting it all going here. And I just think it's the right time to give back. Like, everywhere I go these days in particular, people are like, oh, you're a legend. And I'm like, I am? Okay, great. Okay. But I feel like giving stuff back, you know, because to help out the ones that are talented and competent and proficient, you know, at their craft and capable of pulling it off and doing, you know, doing the hard work that it takes to do it well. And so I'm excited about it.
That's
really
so cool.
Already starting to feel really fun, and I'm gonna go sit in with her in Portland, Oregon, where she lives, and do her like showcase thing and sing with her. Sing, I don't know what yet. Maybe probably her song.
How did you find her?
Well, my husband Jeff's son, Jeffrey, he's this really good, talented scout for good music. He's found so many people before they were huge that he heard first and said, oh, if I could have only signed that person, you know. So that's part of the reason we made the company, because then we can, you know, catch the wave before it, you know, rolls out. And so Jeffrey is part of the company, and we're developing a new artist.
That's so cool.
That's
very cool.
A good thing.
How do you keep that going? What are your tips for a good marriage?
Me and Jeff both are now married together for about 13 years. after we were both previously married for over 22 or 3 years to someone else before. And it's sort of like when you fall in love and you're maybe just old enough to be fully formed, like brain-wise enough to like feel smart enough to know when it's right. Because in your 20s, I don't think you have that yet. When we first got married, we weren't fully formed, emotionally or mentally quite ready to make that huge of a commitment yet. But I mean, I guess it's nature's way too, you know. So when you're a little on the older side, it's more, you go like, wow, this person checks like every box, you know, for me. Like they're funny, I trust them implicitly. You know, I don't feel defensive. I know that they want to protect me and take care of me. I want to protect them and take care of them. They understand my big box to check is they understand my career, because you don't know what it's like until you've sort of done it yourself, to be out on the road or to the travel of it all. That's the real challenge. He was already had worked in movies and in record companies and television, so he knew the entertainment industry really well from all angles. He knows what it's like for me to be sitting in this chair, you know, trying to be charming. So, but he knows what goes into it, and he knows what's behind it all. And totally attracted to this guy, and it just really like the cutest guy in cast pajamas I've ever seen.
He's cute.
So yeah, it's really cute. So we get each other.
That's cool.
All the way, you know. So I don't know how I got so lucky. Aww. I don't know what I'd be doing without him now. Aww. It's really a sweet story.
Too.
Yeah.
You're absolutely gorgeous. I cannot stop staring at you.
Thank
you. And your skin is so beautiful.
Oh, wow.
Like you see,
thanks.
You know, people, you know, you see people all the time, and then when you meet them, like, yeah, they're not as beautiful.
It's all
but
that,
I think you're more beautiful.
It's all that clean living, you know.
Oh, my gosh. No, yeah, what do you attribute it to?
Like, oh, well.
How do you look so good?
Well, thank you. I put a lot of makeup on today. TV makeup. But I think a lot of it's genes. Our mom had beautiful skin, and Anne has amazing skin. Yeah. Lynn has great skin. And people have always said, oh, you have a nice skin. I was like, thank you.
It's unbelievable.
You missed the acne years, but yeah, thanks. But thank you very much. I appreciate it. I mean, it's my birthday. I'm not getting any younger, so. Yeah. So I do my best to get sleep and, you know, drink water and vitamins and yoga and breathing and just do everything possible to kind of, you know, feel young and hopefully look young. And
you sure do. You're gorgeous. Oh, absolutely gorgeous.
I really appreciate that. You do too, by the way. See, now there you
go.
You're self-deprecating.
I know.
No, when my mom said a few times, she said, when somebody gives you a compliment, just say thank you. So,
thank you.
You look beautiful.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
Did that with Jeff a whole bunch, like, oh, you're the apple of my eye. And he was like, oh, goes, no, say thank you. He's like, oh, thank you. It's a good thing.
You're right. Yeah, you're right. Did you always take care of yourself? Like in the early days, were you a partier back in the day? Or did you know better?
No, I didn't know better. I never knew better. I've been pretty out there pretty often in different eras of my life. I had to test the bonds, you know. I had to test the limits a lot. Actually, I was no stranger to a party. Yeah.
What would your younger self tell your older self, rather, tell your younger self?
Oh, I would tell my younger self, don't try to be an actor in movies.
Yeah.
Because I tried to do some acting, My husband at the time, Cameron Crowe, put me in a couple of his movies. And it was like, I was in Fast Times at Ridgemont High.
Oh, gosh, yes.
The Girl in the Car.
Yes, of course,
and
yes.
I was in this other one
Sexy
called...
Sexy Girl in the Car, yes.
This is, yes, The Beautiful Girl in the Car. But it was another one called The Wild Life, where I had speaking lines, and it was really bad. And plus, you have to get up so early if you're an actor. So I can't do that. You know, I'm a night worker. So I set my alarm for 11, you know. So
we should talk about the scores of films that you did work on, however, in those Cameron Crowe films.
And yeah, I worked on most of those films, Almost Famous and Jerry Maguire and Vanilla Sky and a little bit on Say Anything. And I never got to, like, get a real orchestra in there, but I did a lot of temporary type string parts and mostly guitar, mandolin. I played keys and bass and percussion on the most of that stuff myself.
Best soundtrack
so really
ever.
Fun to not be responsible for the lyrics for a change, just music only. So it's also a great learning experience as a musician to make an atmosphere where it's more wide open half the time. So there's not a lot of stuff to clutter. You unclutter the sound. So it's when to shut up is really what you learn how to do, because there's dialogue in the film itself. So you want to just make a soundscape for the dialogue to support the dialogue and not step on the dialogue. So, you know, learning how to, like, simplify and shut up a lot, what not to do, was a really good place for me to get to then later as a songwriter to bring that to. Because sometimes less is way more. You could put air and space and breath into it instead of fill it all up.
When you are writing songs, the whole thing, what comes first, the lyrics or the music?
Usually, lately anyway, the lyrics have come first. I've been really, the muse has been visiting a lot, so I've got a lot of new songs going on. And
who's the muse? Who's the muse?
Who's the muse? Well, the muse is the spirit, you know. It's kind of the bigger than you spirit. It's the magic that's sort of up there floating, waiting to sort of come and find you when it's ready. So you can't predict it. It'll come to you, and then you'll be like, I better write this down right now, you know. Get out of bed quick, you know. Write this down or record into my phone a little melody. Sometimes music comes first if it's a guitar jam or just a riff. But lately it's been words, because I guess I've got a lot to say lately. I don't know. I guess you could testify to that right now. Can't shut
yeah,
her
yeah,
up.
I love it. I don't want to. What's your favorite way to relax when you're not working?
I like to be outside, sit outside, and kind of watch the light turn, and listen to nature, breathe air, you know, like simple stuff. I mean, I like a sauna, I like a hot tub, I like outside. I like to listen to music. I like to work out because it's actually very relaxing to listen to music while you're working out, doing yoga and stuff like that, and big weights and stuff too, but, you know.
What's something you always listen to, like your go-to playlist?
Well, I listen to a lot of the same things over and over when I work out. I listen to the new War on Drugs album called I Don't Live Here Anymore. I listen to Folklore, Taylor Swift a lot. Golden Hour by Casey Musgraves. And then I listened to Stereophonics, an album from way back when, called You Have to Go There to Come Back. Well, I listened to Jeff Beck. When we lost Jeff Beck, I went back to listen to Diamond Dust and that album, Blow by Blow by Jeff Beck. And I really liked the Wolfgang Mammoth album.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's really good. It harkens to the 80s in a good way. Mm-hmm. And I like Brighton, Jerry Cantrell's album. Really, really good.
Yeah, it's good.
I listen to that a lot. And a bunch of stuff like that.
What's your favorite comfort food?
Oh, God. My favorite comfort food would be, I think it would be red velvet chocolate cake.
Oh, good. And we have red velvet chocolate cupcakes in there for you. So you'll have to have that one.
Well,
you gotta eat that.
I have a good excuse because it's my birthday. And I might even have dessert later. And then I'll
work
it off the next day or two.
What about favorite cocktail?
Cocktail?
Yep.
I like a Chopin vodka martini. No vermouth with an olive. Or two olives.
We got that too. I'll have one after. Coffee or tea?
Coffee.
You have a dog?
Dog, yeah.
Okay. I think you have a... Do you have a little bulldog?
I did have a little... I did have a Frenchie, but he's
no
longer.
Oh, I'm sorry.
We got a new puppy who just turned one, who is a Bernedoodle.
Oh,
really?
I love the Bernedoodles.
Yeah, they're. He's pretty big, you know, for a mini, but but you know, at least he's not 150 pounds either. But his name is Bernie, and he's really a good dog.
Aww.
Just never had to take him to training. He's just smart. He listens, you know, he's open for suggestion at all times, and he's really curious, and I swear he knows English language. I mean, he's a really good dog.
Aww.
Bernie, and yeah,
so
the best dog ever.
What's something you always take with you when you travel?
That's a good question, because in my suitcase you're going to find a separate bag with an extension cord. A pair of scissors, Sharpie, and gaffer's tape, and extra paper to write on, you know, if you want to make do not disturb sign for your door if they don't have
one
for
you.
Okay. And a couple of those clips, like from office clips, that you can clip on a vent with a pillowcase if it's blowing on you in the bed.
That's a good one.
I think I've traveled a lot, or not, maybe not, but I've traveled a lot. And pretty much that's my hotel kit.
Awesome. Where's the best place you've ever been?
The best place I've ever been? I think it's at home in my own bed or in my kitchen. Because I love cooking, so
good.
So I'm a pretty good cook. I just like being home. I've been away so much of my whole life.
Yeah.
I like to be on a stage. I love being on a stage.
Well, you are touring.
We're going to be out in June, touring
in
with
June.
The other band.
Okay.
And I have, my singer is Kimberly Nicole, who was a finalist on The Voice a few years ago. She's just a little powerhouse, you know. So she can do a lot of the singing that I cannot do, the heart songs that I cannot sing. They're too high for me. So she just kills them. And there's talk of more heart work coming next year.
Yeah.
So we're just, we're really like, that would be fun.
Awesome.
To do a world tour next year. So get a personal trainer, you know, and... get prep for that, but
I don't think you need it. I think you'd be good.
Well, you know, too much red velvet, I'll have to.
So you're gonna play for us Dog and Butterfly.
Well, my friend Sue Polino is in town. She lives here, and we've done a lot of little gigs around together just for fun, for people's events. But Anne actually wrote those lyrics when she looked out her window and actually saw a dog trying to chase a butterfly, and thought it was just, poetic, you know. This big lunky dog that will never catch the butterfly, but keeps on trying. It's very, you know, it's like a life lesson.
What does music do for people?
Music saves people. Music heals people. And music can befriend people. But it is pretty magical what music does in our lives for us all. You know, I read a little pamphlet once about being a Pisces and the day of the month that my birthday happens on, which is today. And it's, I looked at this, the booklet of the Pisces characteristics, and on my particular day it said, you are a creative, most likely you play music, and if you cannot be creative or musical, you will go insane, and most likely it's a stringed instrument. And
oh,
I was like, am I reading this? Oh my God.
Weird.
And then I looked at the other days throughout the booklet, it's the only one that was like that.
Oh,
it was my day, so
wow.
Like, I do believe.
That's funny. That's neat.
Yeah.
Wow. And Jerry Cantrell's birthday is my birthday, Saturday, on the 18th.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. Pisces.
I know. Do you have a skull ring on, too?
I do.
We both do.
Yeah.
Bump fist.
Yeah.
Jerry showed me this cool thing. You put your fist next to my fist, like this, and then put your pinky out, other or your thumb out, and that one down. Now you go, too much rock for one hand.
Awesome.
That's a Jerry Cantrellism.
Oh, you're kidding.
Too much rock for one hand.
Oh, that's so cool. I love it.
All right.
You're so awesome.
Really fun.
Absolute pleasure to
Thanks.
Have
well,
you here. Thank
lovely,
you. Thank you so
well conducted
much.
Interview, I must say.
Oh,
yeah.
But I look forward to more great stuff
Sweet.
From you. So.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much for coming.
So happy to be here. So good in this room.
Nice sounding room.
Yeah, it is.
One, two, three.
There I was with the old man, stranded again, so off I ran. Young word crashing around me, no possibility. Getting what I need, he looked at me and smiled. Said, no, 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 child. See the dog and butterfly up in the air, he likes to fly. Dog and butterfly. To the sky, to the sky, dog and butterfly. We're getting older, and the world's getting colder. For the life of me, I don't know the reason why. It's living that's making us give in. Our hearts holding in, shaking back on the tide. We're balanced together like a ocean upon the sky. Another night in a strange town, moonlight holding me, light is down. Voice of confusion inside me, just begging to go back to where I'm free. Feels like I'm through. Then the old man's words are true. See the dog and butterfly. In the air he liked to fly. Dog and butterfly. Below she had to try to run back down to the warm soft ground. Moving up to the sky.
Lifeminute.